Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Bring me back to you. Me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my.
Good evening, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our online Bible study. Tonight, we will be continuing our study on the book of Hebrews chapter 4, verses 11 to 16. This part of Hebrews chapter 4 sheds light into two very important truths that we should hold dearly in our faith. First is the Word of God. The Bible itself, as this verses say, is alive inactive. It changes us, molds us, and penetrates our souls. Second is that Jesus is our high priest, meaning he represents us to the Lord, and he is not just any high priest. He is not just a human high priest. He is the greatest and heavenly high priest because he can empathize with our weaknesses, because just as we are, he was tempted in every way. Yet in all of that, unlike us, he did not sin. Brothers and sisters, as we study His Word tonight on Hebrews chapter 4, may we be reminded of these truths and truly apply them into our daily lives. Because if God is truly God in our lives, we will hold His Word as most important to us. And if God is truly God in our lives, again, we will devote our times and even our lives communicating with Him through prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank You and praise You for this opportunity, this privilege that we can come at Your feet, Father, to study Your Word. We come with humble hearts and open hearts, Father, seeking that You will be the one, Father, to truly guide us, to truly inspire us, Father, to understand Your Word tonight. And we pray and ask that, Father, as we listen, we don't just listen intently, but we also, Father, learn to apply this in our lives. May we hold to these two truths, Father, dearly in our lives, Father. And as Your Son has always given, Father, may we truly glorify You with our lives. We just want to commit to You our care groups as well. May You bless our conversations, Father. And most importantly, may You be the center of all of it, Father. We commit to You this time. We thank You again, Father, for this precious privilege. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We should be diligent to enter God's rest by hearing and believing God's word. Our memory verse this week is taken from Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. Tonight, we continue with part 2 of Hebrews chapter 4. But before we start our Bible study, let's commit this time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank You for the opportunity that we could learn Hebrews chapter 4. Father, we commit to You our time. We commit to You the Bible study. May we truly learn from Your word, and may You continue to use me to be a channel of Your message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Part 2 of Hebrews is divided into three parts. Verse 11 is the conclusion of what Sister Charlene shared last week about entering into God's rest. Verses 12 to 13 tells us about how living and powerful the Word of God is. The last three verses speaks about Jesus being our high priest who can sympathize with us. Let's read verse 11. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. The phrase, let us therefore, is mentioned a number of times in the book of Hebrews. This is usually when a teaching is presented, followed by what we need to do based on what we have learned. As we have discussed last week, the rest is there. It is open, and it is an open invitation, but God does not force it upon us. The rest is entered by faith. But it takes diligent faith. This shows us that faith is not passive. It takes diligence to trust in, rely on, and cling to Jesus and His work for us. The rest that God is offering is only made available to those who commit themselves in faith in Him. It's not physical rest, but spiritual rest. It means no more self-effort to please God by our fleshly works. It means to possess the perfect peace that God gives, free from guilt and anxiety. It means to be positionally established in Christ. It means to have complete trust in God's charge of our life. All of these is summed up in the glorious promise of eternal rest in the Lord forever in heaven. The only thing that will stop us from entering that rest is unbelief. So the warning is, do not harden your heart like the Israelites and miss God's perfect rest. Verse 12. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. It seems odd that there was a sudden shift from verse 11 to verse 12. But here the writer of Hebrews is further warning us of the urgency of entering God's rest. When God says something, He means it. God's word will penetrate our hearts to see if we're real or not. We can profess to be Christians, but God's word will cut through us and expose the true condition of our hearts. We know that a sword with two edges has no blunt side. It cuts on both sides. The revelation of God given us in His word is sharp all over. It is alive in every part, and in every part keen to cut the conscience and wound the heart, penetrating the inmost recesses of our spiritual being, as a sword cuts through the joints and marrow of the body. The Bible exposes our weaknesses and unbelief. It demonstrates its inherent power, sharpness, and accuracy. It bears constant reminding that as we submit ourselves to the Word of God, we do it for far more than intellectual knowledge or to learn Bible facts, because God meets us in His Word and the Holy Spirit works perfect, powerfully through the Word of God. The spiritual work goes far beyond the basic educational value of learning the Bible. The Bible isn't a collection of merely old stories and myths. It has inherent life and power. These are some examples of how God's Word can transform us. It prospers us. It provides spiritual cleansing. It heals us. It helps us stay away from sin. It gives us wise counsel. The Bible is alive and gives life to anyone else who will receive it with faith. God's Word reaches us with surprising precision, and the Holy Spirit empowers the ministry of the Word to work deeply in our hearts. It strengthens us, it preserves us, it gives guidance, gives us peace, and it helps us bear fruit. But how come it doesn't affect everyone the same way? On a given Sunday, one can find the message boring while the person next to him is convicted. This is an attitude of the heart. Let's pray that the Lord will continue to give a heart that seeks after Him and delights in His Word. A heart that will be open to correction and rebuke so that we may be truly transformed. The Bible empowers us. It helps us to know Jesus intimately. It brings salvation to those who hears and accepts it. It makes us true followers of Christ. It builds up our faith. Have you ever felt nailed by the Word of God? That a particular passage is so relevant to your life as if the speaker knows what's going on in your life. But it isn't necessarily the speaker at all. It is the sharpness of the Word of God, delivering the message in just the right place. With all these benefits, what's keeping us from reading the Bible? I hope we will be diligent in studying the Word of God. Let's reflect on these questions. Considering how powerful God's Word is, how's your quiet time lately? What impact has reading God's Word made on you? The Word of God is living and powerful. It will give life to anyone who will receive it by faith. We are living at a time where there's so many distractions that can hinder us from spiritual growth. We can spend hours browsing through social media and spend so little time in reading the Bible. While preparing this message, I got nailed by this. May the Lord continue to work in me and in all of us so we can see God for who He is and know Him more through His Word. Verse 13. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. There is no one hidden before God. He sees our hearts, and His Word exposes our true condition with all the disguises ripped off. The facts are laid bare. God can see you just like you are. No matter how young or old we are just a breath away. We must never think that we can go on living our life that way we want to live it and never face God. As Brother Bertram shared 2 weeks ago on our Sunday message, one day we will all stand before the Lord. We must give account for how we have lived our lives. So today, while we hear His voice, we must not harden our hearts. Verse 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. In verses 14 to 16, we see the word therefore again. Salvation is not just about getting a free pass to heaven. The moment we are saved, we are given a special privilege. Jesus cleared the way for man to approach a holy God. The idea that Jesus is our high priest was mentioned before in Hebrews 2:17. Therefore, in all things, He had to be made like His brothers so that He might become a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. And in Hebrews 3:1, therefore, holy brothers and sisters, partakers of heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus. In the Bible, the task of the high priest is to usher men into the presence of God. And when the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies once a year on the Day of Atonement and offer the sacrifice, he is in effect bringing the sins of his people into God to be atoned for he was bearing the people before God. And if one has to be perfect high priest, he would know God perfectly. And he would know men perfectly. Jesus knew both. Jesus knew God perfectly, for he was God. Jesus knew men perfectly, for he was man. Therefore, he becomes the absolute perfect high priest who brought God and man together. No other high priest is perfect because not only did Jesus finish his work on the cross, he ascended to heaven and is sitting on the right hand of the Father interceding for us. No other high priest became fully man and yet endured every form of testing, and yet he never sinned. No other high priest can offer the perfect provision in that Jesus turned that throne of God into a throne of grace, which is what we really need. Verse 15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have a one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. The superiority of Jesus as the Son of God was established in Hebrews 1, while his humanity was emphasized in chapter 2. Both these chapters show us that Jesus, as God the Son, enthroned in heaven, our high priest can fully sympathize with our weaknesses because he was made fully human. He knows and he feels what we go through. The ancient Greek translated sympathize literally means to suffer along with. Sometimes we think that because Jesus is God, he could never know temptation the way we do. In part, this is true. Jesus faced temptation much more severely than we ever have or ever will. The sinless one knows temptation in ways we don't, because the only one who never gives into temptation knows the full strength of temptation. It is true that Jesus never faced temptation in an inner sense the way we do, because there was never a sinful nature pulling him to sin from the inside. But he knew the strength and fury of external temptation in a way and to a degree that we can never know. For the last verse, verse 16, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Because we have a high priest who is both omnipotent and compassionate, we can approach his throne with confidence. Discouraging us from this access is a central strategy of Satan. The devil sometimes wants us to consider Jesus as unapproachable. The dictionary shows us that the word confidence means faith or belief that one will act in a right, proper, or effective way. This definition explains the importance of having confidence in being a follower of Jesus Christ. The Bible speaks about how important it is for us to live out our lives confidently, trusting in the Lord. The Lord knows everything about us, and yet He accepts us. Psalms 86:5 says, reminds us that the Lord is good and ready to forgive, abundant in mercy to all who call upon Him. Though we are unfaithful, He remains faithful. The throne of God is a throne of grace. When we come, we may obtain mercy. This is not getting what we deserve. And find grace. This is what we don't deserve in our time of need. Ancient Jewish rabbis taught that God had two thrones, one of mercy and one of judgment. They said this because they knew that God was both merciful and just, but they could not reconcile these two attributes of God. They thought that perhaps God had two thrones to display the two aspects of His character. On one throne, He showed judgment, and on the other throne of mercy. But here, in the light of the finished work of Jesus, we see mercy and judgment reconciled into one throne of grace. Let's reflect on these questions as we finish. How does knowing that Jesus is our high priest change the way you see Him? What hinders you from approaching God's throne of grace with confidence? Remember that grace does not ignore God's justice. It operates in fulfillment of God's justice in light of the cross. Thankfully, God provides help in our time of need. No request is too small or too big. As Philippians 4:6 tells us, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and pleading with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We have used the following reference in preparing for tonight's Bible study. We pray that you were encouraged as much as we were as we studied this chapter. Hope you will have a fruitful fellowship. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you for Hebrews chapter 4. We truly learned a lot of things in this chapter. We pray, Father, that may you continue to work in each and every one of us, that we may be faithful to you, and we thank you for being faithful to us all the time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. Thank you for joining our Friday night Bible study care group fellowship. This Lord's Day, let us learn more about humility from our perfect model, our selfless Jesus, Our speaker is Pastor Christopher Young. See you at CGCQC on-site at 10 a.m. Next Friday night, we shall continue our marvelous Bible study series on Hebrews as Sister Irene Tu shares with us Chapter 5, focusing on the subject of Jesus, our perfect priest. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. God bless and stay safe.